When you look at Douglas today with its empty beach, it's hard to imagine what it was like 100 years ago. Because, believe it or not, at the beginning of the last century, the Isle of Man was one of the most popular holiday resorts in the whole of the British Isles. And millions, yes, millions of people came through here, Douglas Harbour, to start a fantastic summer holiday, which they'd remember for the rest of their lives.
Passengers leave the boat with a smile, greet Douglas. It's a good thing to be ashore again. Hey, be careful, that's a young lady.
Just look at them, pouring off the boats in these archive films from the last century. They couldn't wait to get ashore and sample the pleasures of the Isle of Man. And when they got here, there were comfortable hotels like this one on the Queen's Promenade.
In Douglas, you don't have to pay in advance. The young lady in the office greeted us with a genuine Manx smile.
Well, you don't see many of those nowadays. There were sandy beaches. All sorts of entertainment. The quaint locals to look at. Walks in the country. And lots of other holidaymakers to get to know. And who knows, maybe have a romance with.
Nowadays, it's hard to imagine that in the height of summer 100 years ago, you could hardly move along Douglas Promenade because it was so packed full of people. But where had they all come from? Why were they here? And what had the Isle of Man done to become so popular?
Part of the reason was that in the UK, since the Industrial Revolution, the working man, and woman, had gradually won better working conditions, better pay, and some annual holiday. This meant that each year, thousands of workers from the north of England and from Scotland took a week's leave and went on holiday. The Isle of Man was one of the favourite places to come to. Excellent beaches, theatres, cinemas, amusement halls, trams and steam trains all added to the attraction. And the fact that you came here on a boat made it feel like a real expedition.
It was just like going abroad without actually leaving Britain. There was all the excitement of the sea journey. You could still use English money, eat all your favourite English foods, and see all the famous stars of the music hall when you got here. But at the same time, it still felt rather exotic, as one advertising brochure explained.
Soon the steamer slows down alongside the Victoria Pier, and we step ashore half inclined and wholly willing to believe that we have landed on some foreign shore, as we watch the keen, dark faces of the native Manx people and listen to their strangely intoned voices.
Well, I don't know about keen, dark faces and strangely intoned voices. Many of the accents you would have heard along this promenade 100 years ago would have been from the north of England. Because as the holiday trade expanded over here, many businessmen came over from the north and set up as hoteliers. They ran cafes and many places of amusement.
But all this success as a holiday resort had humble beginnings, because 150 years ago, Douglas was a sleepy little seaside town whose main occupation was fishing. The town was merely a huddle of houses around the mouth of a river. There was no promenade, and the cottages which ran along the side of what we now know as Strand Street backed onto the beach, and were sometimes flooded by the high tides. In those days, it was known as Sand Street.
There's very little of the old town left today, though some of the shops in Strand Street, even though they've got modern fronts, are actually quite old. And just round here, in a lane behind Strand Street, there's the remains of an old sea wall. The beach actually came up to here, and this is the original sea wall that protected the fishermen's cottages which stood here in the early 1800s. It wasn't until the Loch Promenade was built in 1876 with its splendid hotels that this area was finally protected from the sea.
So how did the small fishing village of Douglas of the 1820s develop into one of the main holiday resorts in the British Isles by 1900? Certainly in the early years, Douglas had little to offer. No piped water or sewage disposal, very little street lighting, poor roads and dirty streets with run-down houses huddled together, ideal for pickpockets and insolent children. And young lads driving their bread carts too fast were a real menace. Nowadays, they drive GTIs.
What changed the fortunes of Douglas was a combination of things which happened to occur round about the same time. Firstly, technology improved. The steamship was invented, and by 1830, the first regular service to the island was operating.
This reliable service made a huge difference to the island. Before this time, it could take days to get here from England. The sailing ships from Liverpool or Whitehaven in Cumbria were often blown back and forth across the sea, entirely at the mercy of the weather. And some passengers reported a journey of 5 days from England, a journey which took less than 5 hours by steamship.
The new technology of the Industrial Revolution, which made the steamship possible, actually produced appalling living conditions for the working class in England. But gradually, social reform took hold, and with the increased unionisation of the British workforce, the idea of the annual holiday became universal. Hundreds of thousands of workers, from the Scottish shipyards in the north to the factories of Yorkshire and Lancashire, had saved all year, and they were ready to holiday. And the Isle of Man was one of their favourite destinations.
By the time the mill workers had started coming for holidays, getting to the island was relatively easy. A speedy train network throughout Britain brought them to ports such as Liverpool, Fleetwood and Ardrossan, and the steam packet boats brought them to here, Douglas Harbour, where they were efficiently offloaded, met by porters, horse trams or horse-drawn taxis, and taken to their various boarding houses.
But it wasn't quite as simple as that. For many years, Douglas Harbour had been notorious as a place where it was near impossible to get on and off boats, which you might reasonably think would be one of the main functions of a harbour. The problem was that until 1878, when this pier, the Victoria Pier, was finished, boats could not dock in Douglas at low tide, because the only pier available was further up the harbour, and the water wasn't deep enough to allow the paddle steamers to dock. The only way for you to get ashore was for your paddle steamer to anchor in the bay out there, and for small rowing boats to row out, pick up you and your luggage, and return you to the shore. This was definitely the worst part of the whole journey, because you were at the mercy of the infamous Douglas boatmen.
For decades, the complaints about these boatmen filled endless columns in the island's newspapers. The boatmen were regarded as rude, smelly, and always trying to get more money. This charming print of Douglas Bay with ships at anchor might look ideal, but those small boats surrounding them are not on a pleasure trip. Far from it. They will contain terrified passengers being ferried ashore who have just been told that if they don't pay twice what was originally agreed, they wouldn't get their luggage back.
The situation was intolerable. Many Douglas businessmen called for something to be done about the state of affairs, as it was a real deterrent for people coming to the island. Schemes were introduced to try and license and regulate the boatmen, and at one point, a constable was stationed on the pier to try and control them. They took little notice, and the complaints continued to pour in. A letter to the papers from one gentleman was typical.
Sir, having recently arrived by steamer at the Isle of Man, I agreed what seemed a reasonable payment for the conveyance of myself, my luggage and my companions from the steamer to the shore by one of the local boatmen. On proceeding further, however, I was demanded a shilling, and upon my arrival half a crown was insisted upon, which, if not paid instantly, my luggage would be detained. This, observe, occurred at the very early hour of 1 o'clock a.m., I was peculiarly circumstanced, having two ladies under my protection, who were not only in a singular way the objects of these slaves' rapacity, but were really in danger of their lives from the terror which such conduct naturally inspires in the female breast. I was determined to investigate the cause, why, in your island, such aggressions should be permitted as would be too much to expect on the coast of Barbary. I trust that those who have such power to insist on justice will subject this order of men and their traffic to proper regulations. I am, sir, your humble servant, a traveller.
It was eventually decided that the only way to overcome this unacceptable situation was to extend the Victoria Pier out into deep water, so that ships could come alongside at all states of the tide. And in 1878, the Douglas boatmen were finally put out of business, and a new era in Manx tourism was launched.
That didn't stop people complaining, though, and the one thing that was on everyone's minds was bathing.
In the 1840s, there were only a few houses along here, and this was just a simple shore. The handful of tourists that did find their way to Douglas could bathe completely nude if they wanted to, and many did. The health-giving properties of sea bathing was just beginning to catch on, and believe it or not, nude bathing was popular.
On one occasion, though, a lady in one of these houses complained to the town commissioners that she found this type of bathing objectionable opposite her door. The bathers were moved further away, and some days later, a member of the town board met with the lady and expressed the hope that this change was satisfactory. "It is not a bit better," she replied. "My girls now simply look through the window with the glasses." The problem was to get worse. As the Victorian era progressed, the moral code became stricter, like an ever-tightening corset, and what you could and couldn't do in public became more and more regulated. By the time Douglas was becoming really popular in the 1880s and 90s, nude bathing would have been unthinkable, even wearing the sorts of swimwear we wear today, such as a bikini and speedos, would have caused outrage, and one had to take great care when changing into one's swimming costume so as not to cause offence.
In those days, the bathing vans were much in evidence on Douglas Beach. You had to change inside one of these to ensure that no one saw anything that they shouldn't. But it seems that some people just wouldn't cooperate, as another letter to the paper made quite clear.
"Sir, permit me through the medium of your paper to express my disgust at the constant and disagreeable nuisance of people bathing on the sands, even at the time of high water, without using the machines. And not unfrequently will they undress against the wall and run to the water, subjecting anyone who should be passing by to much unpleasantness. May I hint to the proprietors of the bathing machines the desirability of apportioning different localities for males and females so far asunder as to do away with the indecent exposures that are continually taking place? I am, sir, yours respectfully, a matron."
It seems as though some matrons actually made sure they were passing here, purely to spot the exposures and report them to the authorities, of course. Partly because of complaints from people like that matron, the moral code became even tighter, and eventually mixed bathing was banned. Douglas Corporation had to actually pass a bylaw which separated men and women on this beach. Men could only bathe if they were 100 yards away from the women, and the bathing vans had to be kept apart as well. Anyone over 10 years of age had to be clothed, men had to wear drawers, and women had to wear an appropriate gown or dress. This was all to prevent the opposite sexes from seeing too much bare flesh. Well, families objected to being separated on the beach. I mean, after all, they were on a family holiday. So the corporation came up with a solution, a family beach. And here it is at Port Jack. And it's probably the worst beach on the island. It's packed full of stones and it's got a great big sewer running through it. But it was the only place that families could come and bathe together. Though it's quite clear from those early postcards that there were lots of people who turned up to just stand and stare. It was certainly a popular beach for onlookers.
But despite these minor problems, tourism was growing enormously on the island. It soon became the main plank of the island's economy. And one year, in the early part of the last century, over 650,000 people came here for their summer holiday. Some days, so many people wanted to travel on the electric railway that when you bought your ticket, you got a horse tram back along the promenade to the end of the queue. And look at this film of Prospect Hill from 1920. Crowds of people streaming down from the upper part of the town to start a day's fun in Douglas.
By the time Queen Victoria died in 1901 and the Edwardian era was ushered in, Douglas was the preeminent resort in the British Isles. It was the most popular holiday destination because it offered the two things that people on holiday most needed: catering and entertainment.
As the excited tourists poured off the boats day after day throughout the season, hundreds of thousands of them, the first thing they would be looking for was somewhere to stay. Many of them didn't book before they came, because in those days there were so many boarding houses here that you could be almost certain to find a bed on spec.
Everyone was at it, catering for the holidaymaker. And it wasn't just these terraces of boarding houses on the Douglas front that took in people. The whole town was in the business of seeing to the wants and needs of the tourist. Books Road. These were all boarding houses. Murray's Road, full of landladies. The husbands may have been out at work, but if the lady of the house could squeeze a few guests in, then it meant extra money for the household. And it was the same in Derby Square, Hutchinson Square, Derby Road, all up and down Broadway, and along Castlemona Avenue. And of course, the promenade. Altogether, hundreds and hundreds of boarding houses and guest houses were available to cater for the thousands of people that needed to be fed and watered between May and September, the main visiting season, each year.
There was even a holiday camp here in Douglas, the first holiday camp in the British Isles. It was called Cunningham's Camp, after its founder. It catered for men only. Women were strictly forbidden. There was no drinking on the premises, and the men really did sleep in tents, but it was fantastically popular. The food was superb, and there was plenty of it, as well as all sorts of entertainment. The old entrance to the camp is still visible on a little road that runs up off the promenade. There was a chairlift inside which took you up to the camp. Unique in the world, the remains of this lift are now rotting away, unused since the 1960s.
But there's a happier story down here, because one of the things that Douglas can be justifiably proud of is the marvellous architecture of these seaside buildings. The seafront here at Douglas is one of the glories of the town. These buildings were for people on holiday, people having fun, and they were designed and decorated to match the holiday mood.
There were towers and crenellations, and patterns and motifs worked into the cement render to make the buildings fun to look at. Wherever they could, the architects used decoration. The insides were beautiful as well. In fact, looking at early photographs of the interiors of the hotels shortly after they opened, they looked really sumptuous. Elegant drawing rooms with comfortable furniture and potted palms. Elegant dining rooms with silver service and napkins. And the more expensive bedrooms had that all-important sea view. It has to be said, though, that not all the hotels and boarding houses were of the same standard. The ones on the prom were the most expensive, the poshest. The further you got back from the prom, the less elaborate the accommodation became, and in some cases, it could be quite basic. But for many people in the Edwardian period, having running water in your bedroom was a real novelty, especially if one of those taps produced hot water. In recent years, many of the original hotels on the Douglas seafront have been pulled down and are being replaced by apartments. The great days of the Manx tourist industry are long since past. We no longer cater for hundreds of thousands of people every year.
But the island does still need hotel accommodation, and for the hotels that survive the decline in tourism, there's a lot of business around. The industry may be a lot smaller than it once was, but it's quite healthy.
If you go into some of the surviving hotels on the prom today, you can still see many of the original features, dating from when they were built 100 years ago. This is the Hydro on Queen's Promenade, built in 1910, at the height of the boom years. And, like all the other hotels in this terrace, it features some rather special plasterwork. The ceilings of all the main rooms in these hotels are marvellously ornate, and Alexander Gill, who developed most of the Douglas seafront, prided himself on the quality of these buildings.
Those ornate ceilings are still here, as is much of the decorative plasterwork around the hotel, although it must be a really fiddly job to paint them. The Hydro is an interesting case history of a Douglas hotel because we have a complete photographic record of it from the day it opened, and I have here the earliest brochure featuring the hotel from 1910. It's rather worse for wear, but it's fascinating to look at.
When it opened, it was the newest and latest thing, and it's interesting to see how fashions have changed over 90 years. And whenever funding allowed, the owner would try and reflect those latest fashions. This is the lounge, or the drawing room as they called it, with a mirror at the far end. Large mirrors were often used in the hotels to give the impression of space and light. This is the same room 20 years later. The mirror has gone, and the leather furniture and dark decor is typical of the period. In the 1960s, fashions changed again, and it looked like this.
And this is what it's like today. Now, the present owners have made a few modifications, because when the hotel was originally built, the entrance from the street here went through into the entrance hall here, and not into the lounge here, as it does today.
The hall has changed as well. Starting with white-painted wood, coloured tiles at the sides and a checkered tiled floor, to the darker period of the 30s and 40s, and on to the 60s. This is the smoking room, and when this was first opened, it was almost like the lounge of a private house, with net curtains, oil paintings on the walls, and a piano. And this is one of the first floor bedrooms. Net curtains, Venetian blinds, potted plants, a very well-appointed room.
Today, all these bedrooms have had to be altered because people want ensuite rooms. They want their own private shower and bathroom. Not like the 1920s when all you had was a wash basin in the corner and a potty under the bed.
Perhaps the most magnificent room in the hotel was the dining room. Huge mirrors were a feature here as well, and over 170 guests could sit down to a meal at one sitting.
It's still a fine room today, although it's catering for a very different type of holidaymaker than the one of 90 years ago. The catering of 90 or 100 years ago was a real marvel. These hotels did full board, and that meant that guests got a full-cooked English breakfast, a hot lunch, afternoon tea, a cooked evening meal, and a cold supper served between 9 and 11pm. And in this hotel alone, they could be cooking up to 500 meals a day, and that didn't include afternoon tea or supper.
The amount of food being brought down to the town each day to service all these hotels and boarding houses was phenomenal. All the surrounding farms were dedicated to producing milk, eggs, meat and vegetables, which were brought in fresh every day in the early morning. Huge numbers of staff were required to cook, wait on in the dining rooms, make the beds and clean the rooms. And girls from all around Britain and Ireland would come here for the summer months to work.
By the time the Hydro was opened in the early 1900s, guests expected to be waited on. But in the earlier decades, things were rather different. Before full-board hotels became the norm, guests had to actually buy their own food from local shops, and the landlady cooked it for them. This meant she could be cooking up to 5 or 6 different meals at any one time. These really were boarding houses. The landlady provided the beds, and the guests provided their own bacon and vegetables and bread and even eggs, which they had to label with their own name so the landlady knew it was theirs. Sometimes landladies gained reputations for being mean with the food, and they became the butt of many seaside postcard jokes.
Good board here.
Yes, tastes like sawdust. Who puts the butter on the bread, Mrs. Jones?
I do, sir.
And who scrapes it off again?
Ooh! Well, as you can imagine, some landladies didn't like this image of themselves. In fact, Douglas as a town was very careful about the image and the morality of the postcards it sold. Believe it or not, up until quite recently there was a postcard censoring committee, which actually vetted every postcard to be sold on the island. And now, finally, after all these years, I can show you the postcards that were forbidden from being sold. The R on them stands for refused. Brace yourselves.
I asked for a room with a view.
That's all right, dear. We've got it.
Refused.
I'm full of vigour, showing off my figure.
Refused.
I'm not considering other folk here. It's my holiday. Cheerio.
Brazen hussy.
Says you, big boy.
You can't wear that costume. It's against the rules.
Refused.
How shocking. How things have changed. Well, if you did want some real fun that nobody could complain about, then Douglas, indeed the whole of the Isle of Man, had a huge amount to offer, making it one of the leading seaside resorts in the whole of the British Isles.
As the excited tourists arrived on the boats, they could see many of the attractions that were waiting for them. There were any number of theatres, music halls, bars and amusement arcades, as well as the beaches and the countryside to enjoy. But one of the most popular places where you could spend a whole day and still not see everything was Douglas Head.
It was known as the world-famous Douglas Head because there was so much to do up here. But your day probably started down there. The journey to Douglas Head started with a trip across the harbour on one of the special ferries. There was music on board and a festive atmosphere. And when you got off the ferry here, it was just a short walk to the first entertainment. Just up from the harbour here were amusement stalls, a man who guessed your weight and gave you your penny back if he was wrong, an open-air swimming pool down there, and the way up to the head. There were steps to walk up, but the real treat, if you could afford it, was to use the funicular railway, which ran up here.
When you got off, the first thing to see was the camera obscura. Now, it really is obscured at the moment because it's hidden inside this protective metal box, undergoing restoration. The camera obscura was a marvellous invention, with 12 lenses around the top on the outside, which projected pictures inside of everything that was going on. It was particularly good for spying on courting couples, which is really why everyone paid to go in. The obscura is currently being restored to its original condition.
Walking up from here, you came to the first set of amusement arcades with every sort of penny slot machine you could dream of. Up there on the head where the apartments now stand, there was a pub with a bar and a place to eat, and another amusement arcade where Manx Radio now is. And from just down here, the start of a tramway.
This was the Marine Drive tramway that ran south along a high coastal road, giving dramatic views of the cliffs below to another amusement resort, Port Sodric.
And as you went along on the tram, you might have heard the sound of music.
Flanagan, Flanagan, if you love your Mary Ann, oh, 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 Flanagan, take me to the Isle of Man.
Because just up from the track here, below the hotel, was this Piero Theatre, where singing, dancing and comedy acts will be performed all day long.
Suddenly hit on a brilliant plan. Could we both stay at home, say? Marry me, dear, with the LSD.
At the end of Marine Drive at Port Sodric, there was a hotel, a smuggler's cave, a cliff railway, a glen, swings, boating trips, and a walk along the cliffs to see the oyster beds.
What more could you want? And Douglas Prom was just as full of things to do. There were music halls where you could sit and sing along with a piano, singing the latest hits of the day. And the Gaiety Theatre, with seating for up to 1,500 people, running its summer show. And the Villa Marina. There was lots to do in here as well.
Chair and doze, while others take tea. And this little lady, she's having fun too. Well, for the tired accountant, well, here's just the thing to show how good he really is at figures.
This was run by Douglas Corporation and had shows and dancing, a cafe, and the famous gardens with music throughout the day and, once a week, a bathing beauty contest.
That gives us the winner, number 10, a nice round figure.
At the Crescent, there was a pavilion for Pieros, and an indoor theatre and a cinema.
At one time, Douglas boasted 5 cinemas showing up to 3 programmes a day, ideal for those wet afternoons. But when the sun was out, the beach was the place to be. You can hardly believe today what this beach once looked like. Right up until the 1960s, on a sunny day, you could hardly find a place to sit. And these areas along the prom were used for storing deck chairs for hire, and it was where ice creams were sold all day long.
This is what it once looked like, the bucket and spade holiday. Punch and Judy, donkeys, safe swimming, beach games, and the simple fun of building sandcastles. They're always so busy. Just look how some people dressed, though.
definitely more
Even
help.
50 years after the bylaws on mixed bathing were scrapped, some people still felt they had to dress for the beach.
Here, where the Hilton Hotel now stands, was one of the biggest entertainment complexes in Douglas, the Palace.
There was a huge theatre which seated up to 2,000 people, and behind it, the Palace Ballroom, reputedly the largest ballroom in Europe. Here, there was dancing, concerts, and exhibitions.
It's hard to imagine today, when you stand in the car park next to the Palace Cinemas, that this area once had 2,000 or 3,000 people dancing in it. And on the hill up there, there was even more entertainment.
Up from the palace was the Falcon Cliff, where there was another huge ballroom, built of iron and glass, like a giant conservatory.
You reached it by riding on this cliff lift, which came down to collect you. Sadly, though, it's been derelict for years.
At the far end of the promenade, where Summerland now stands, was the Derby Castle, another giant amusement complex. There was a theatre and a ballroom where all the famous bands and musical stars would perform. And on Onken Head was White City, a fun fair with a ghost train, fortune tellers, slot machines, dodgem cars, slides and a wooden-built roller coaster.
The roller coaster used to be here, but it and White City are long gone. It's mostly apartments now. So, you can see that you'd never be bored in Douglas. But of course, Douglas was only a part of what the island had to offer. Outside the capital, there were dozens of places to visit. And what made visiting them so special was the way you got there, on the trains and the trams.
And here's something you haven't got in your hometown. Let me introduce you to Nipper, the pride of the force, and the horse tram.
For over 130 years, the island has boasted some fairly unusual transport, the first of which would greet the holidaymaker as soon as they stepped off the boat, the horse trams.
But even so, you give me a bright morning and a sea breeze from behind the horse, and the world is mine.
There were cable cars that ran up Victoria Street and around the upper part of the town, as well as a variety of buses, charabangs, and horse-drawn vehicles. But it was the electric trams and the steam trains which were the big attraction. The Manx Electric Railway carried hundreds of thousands of people every year up the east coast of the island to Laxey and Ramsey. It was built in 1893, and is now the oldest electric railway still being used anywhere in the world. Laxey had been a sleepy and quiet mining village. Just imagine the impact when, in that first year, thousands of people arrived during the summer months. Laxey responded. Cafes and pleasure gardens were opened, and very soon the railway was extended to reach the summit of the island's only mountain, Snae Fell. On their way up, visitors were encouraged to get off at the bungalow stop and take a detour down to Sulby Glen, where there were refreshment rooms and country walks. Further north, Ramsey had the Murrick Park to offer, as well as the Victorian Pier and excellent beaches. Meanwhile, the steam train, which also ran from Douglas, reached Peel. On Sundays, visitors could stop off at Braddon for the huge open-air services that were held in the field behind the church. Once in Peel, they could stroll around the castle, but the main point of attraction was the fishing industry. In particular, the herring houses, where the freshly caught fish were smoked and made into the famous Manx kippers.
One of the girls offers to let little Sheila have a try. But Mum doesn't want to spend her holiday washing fishy clothes. So they pass on to where the herrings, after being cleaned, are got ready for smoking.
The steam railway also ran south, stopping off at one of the tourists' favourite spots, Russian Abbey, famous for its strawberry teas and dancing. Port St Mary and Port Erin were also popular, with their safe beaches, and both had thriving hotels and boarding houses for those seeking a quieter holiday away from the noise and bright lights of Douglas. And there were other places as well, like Silverdale and Glenwillan, ideal for children.
With petrol engines and all. Boats that a guy can get in and drive himself. Oh, gee whiz, mister, don't tell me my time ain't up yet, is it?
And of course, there was the TT, the Tourist Trophy Motorcycle Races. Ever since they started in 1907, they have been the bedrock of the holiday season for the island. Hoteliers used to say that if you weren't packed out for that fortnight, then you never would be. Follow one another at 30-second intervals.
The village of Kirkmichael, with its deserted street, and every dog and cat off the road and safely under lock and key.
So the island could compete with any of the other resorts around the British Isles. It had fantastic scenery, an endless array of entertainment with all the big name stars from London appearing here, huge numbers of hotels opposite perfect beaches, and the excitement of a sea voyage to get here. It had it made. But between 1950 and 1980, something went wrong. The island's tourist industry went into a decline it never recovered from. Hotels were sold off, amusements throughout the island just disappeared, and the Douglas landlady became an extinct species. What went wrong? What caused such a dramatic downturn in the island's main economic strength? These are some of the films from the island's Department of Tourism and Leisure archive. They were made to advertise the island over a period of about 90 years. The Department of Tourism, or the Tourist Board as it used to be known, would regularly commission films that would be shown around Britain in the winter months to try and persuade people to come and spend their summer holidays here. And now it's the most valuable archive we have of films about the island. Fascinating to watch these because not only do they show us aspects of the island that have long since disappeared, but they also show us how the image of the island has changed over the years.
The young and the not so young give shape to their dreams in sand.
Sometimes the films emphasise the bucket and spade holiday, the fun of the beach and the noise of a lively seaside resort like Douglas.
They would never believe me if I told them at the office.
At other times, the tourist board obviously felt they should cater for a different type of holiday, the romantic one, ideal for young lovers in the secluded glens or out on the moorlands enjoying the scenery.
But there's one film here made in 1949 that unwittingly showed the seeds of the downfall of the Manx tourist industry. Just watch this opening section.
So far as I know, there are only two ways of getting to the island, by sea or by air. Of course, you could swim, but no one's done that yet, not even a seal. The Midland and the North Country folk have gone air-minded in a big way. That is, so far as the Isle of Man is concerned. Thanks to their patronage, Ronald's Way Civil Airport now holds the record in the United Kingdom for the number of air movements in any one day. Aeroplanes literally drop in on you here from all over the place. One guy even flew in with his whole household of furniture in an aero van. And so it goes on, plane after plane, bringing in every hour its endless stream of landlady's joy, the visitor. Whoever said the British weren't air-minded ought to take a trip in one of these magnificent 32-seater air charabancs. but that's how they look.
Air travel, advertised in 1949 as the most modern and exciting way to get to the Isle of Man. The island had a new airport, and air travel was the quick and fashionable way to get here. The trouble was that those same aircraft would soon be taking tourists not to the Isle of Man, but to Spain, the Costa Brava, the Costa del Sol, where the sun was guaranteed, and later to Florida, Disneyland, and beyond.
Castles down and castles up, for here at Derby Castle, once the site of a famous variety theatre at the north end of Douglas Promenade, is taking shape one of the most exciting holiday projects in the world. A complete complex of entertainment undercover to keep Douglas ahead in the holiday field, whatever the weather might do.
The island fought back. The great entertainment complex of Summerland was built, with proposals for an indoor beach and all-weather entertainment.
A solarium, where artificial sunshine will give that gorgeous tan even if it is raining. Cascading waterfalls will use the cliff face as backing, and there will be terraces of entertainments. Even an artificial beach lapped by the waters of its own blue lagoon. One of the most advanced projects in the world, this is an expensive idea. But the Manx believe in looking ahead with the most modern, while maintaining that which gives their island its individual...
And the emphasis changed from the beach holiday to the activity holiday. Rambling, fishing, cycling, and the discovery of a unique history and heritage on the island was the new marketing ploy.
But the decline in visitor numbers was steady and unstoppable. And as foreign travel became cheaper and easier, the cost of getting to the Isle of Man went up, as shipping companies and airlines had to charge more to keep the routes viable.
Hotels started to close. The theatres and the ballrooms were demolished. And large sections of the railways were closed and removed.
Some hoteliers went bankrupt, others faced a desperate struggle to survive. And by the time of the 1980s, along here, you could have bought a redundant hotel for as little as £12,000 at auction, the same price as a car today.
There was huge pressure on the government, especially the tourist board, to reverse the trend. And huge amounts of money were spent on advertising campaigns and advertising agencies.
And from the old in the south to the new in the east, with gay, sophisticated pleasure grounds like Port Sodrick, with its carefree continental atmosphere. Oh yes, the view is quite splendid.
But sadly, the decline was inevitable, and the industry, which once was the backbone of the island's economy and produced thousands of jobs, now only plays a small part. The island now relies on a new industry, the finance sector.
But those hotels that have survived are doing a very healthy trade. And although it's a much smaller industry, there's an endless stream of businessmen, consultants, engineers, all sorts of people coming to the island needing hotel accommodation. As regards tourists, the island now markets itself as a heritage island, with plenty of activities, good food, a great place for a safe family holiday. But it's true to say that the glory days of the island's tourist industry 100 years ago have gone forever. Never again will we see the crowded beaches, the queues for the trams, the theatres and the dance halls, the Piero shows and the fun of a simple seaside holiday.
It was an extraordinary time in the island's history. From being a remote island community at the beginning of the Victorian era, it flowered to become the centre of the British Isles in terms of tourism, a hub of a vibrant industry that bloomed and faded away again in the space of just two generations. The old postcards and the remaining hotels are practically the only reminders we have of an industry that once affected the lives of millions.
Douglas's magnificent ballrooms.
Mm-hmm.
now it's time to be saying goodbye to the island, with many happy memories to be treasured and talked over when they get home. There are memories enough for all of them, until next year, when they'll be saying hello again to the Isle of Man, the Isle of Beauty.